Oh, that's what it is.
No question.
Good God, Bo, we're on TV now. We can't.
Oh, Nydia. Oh, dear.
Hang on.
Hey, Nydia.
Here, Mo, here's your minute. I'll go back and go get it.
So what I was saying, who's sitting here? You. Okay. George is here. Okay.
I mean, he fell down on the deck.
John Kendall, and he is the outside attorney for Bluegrass Materials.
How are you doing?
And it's John for Jonathan.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
I send you too much information, but you might find a kernel that's worth a while.
I appreciate the email.
You're very welcome.
It was a report.
Take your word for it. I try my best not to be famous.
But the report was, you know, it's sprayed up and showed up at the last minute.
Oh, yeah. The water.
Oh, yeah. Water.
Never even. Report, yeah. It was from back in April, which
And then it was. If it was written such that it had more disclaimers and waivers and said, don't rely on this.
Has everyone signed in?
I didn't even bring any.
Has everyone signed in?
I did. I didn't even bring any of my files up.
Thank you.
So they've got like conflicting statements.
I want to
if someone says you get more than 20 people on the front of the room, you know, I'm going to show up.
Then there is a possibility.
With Matt, I'm not so bad.
With different developers, because you can't make as much dough now.
They always do that anyway.
Yeah, but so far he has developed everything that he wanted.
Did he develop it?
Yeah, but the one that is. That
owns
it now. The one.
Yeah.
I didn't say that.
Yeah. Hey, I said to him in his face, you're a
liar.
Don't sue me. It'll be fun.
Delay.
Well, there's two of them over there.
The one that
concrete and the other.
Thank you. I was going to ask you for a card. It's because the manager at Vinny's, the restaurant in Windward, was asking me how he could contact you because he's upset about the county using SPLOST money to put in the tennis courts at Fowler Park, and now the county is going to charge the residents to use it. And he's like, they should never allow us to pay for it, and they're going to reap the benefits from it. Because I don't want to pay to use the tennis court. I pay for it out of sports. Yeah, and I told him, so that I would send your details. So I have your card.
As far as you know, is there anyone else coming? Not here yet?
Good evening, everyone. My name is Craig Griffin. I'm the site manager, and I want to welcome you all to Bluegrass Cummings Quarry. We've been Bluegrass Materials for about 6 months now, and we want to thank you all for coming. First thing I want to do while I'm here, I want to go over a few ground rules that we have today. We want everyone to respect with others, and let one person speak at a time. It's number one. Number two, we want to turn off our phones and the ringers if possible so that they won't disturb anyone. If you have to make a call, we would appreciate it if you walk outside the room and make your call. We're here tonight to discuss the noise variance. Use our neighborhood advisory committee. We want to sign in a sheet. If there's any other things y'all want to talk about, just sign the sheet and we will get together later today. There will be an opportunity for questions at the end of the presentation. That's number four. And if you must ask a question during the presentation, please raise your hand so that the speaker can acknowledge you. As far as this site goes, the facility, if you have to use the bathroom, when you go out this door here, where you all came in the hallway, just make the left, and you go out this door, make the right, and the right is down on the left. Ladies and men on the same side, ladies on the right, men's on the left. And at this time, there's a few safety rules we want to go over with y'all, and our safety director, Brian McIntyre, will do that for us this afternoon.
Hi, I'm Brian. This is a federally regulated area for the Mine Safety and Health Administration, and for that reason, we ask that you stay within the confines of the building, within the confines of the parking lot. A miner is allowed to go out there, but they have to receive 24 hours of training. So at this point, we would just ask that you stay within this building. If there's any medical emergencies or first aid training people on site, we have an automatic internal defibrillator and a first aid kit. We would ask that you follow any directions of the Bluegrass staff. If we have to leave this building, we would muster out in the parking lot to make sure that we have everybody accounted for. If you have any questions, feel free to ask.
You ready?
Introductions. We're going to go around the room and let everybody that's associated with Bluegrass or that works for Bluegrass introduce themselves. My name is Pat Mullaney. I'm the sales manager at this plant. And if everybody else can just stand up and say who you are, Matt, who you're representing.
I'm Matt Bilson with FiberTech.
I'm Joyce Ann Lee. I'm the environmental manager for Bluegrass Materials.
I'm Matt Engel. I'm with FiberTech.
I'm John Kendall. I'm an attorney with Nelson Mullins, outside counsel for Bluegrass. I met both you guys. Mm-hmm. Thanks for coming.
I'm Ted Baker. I'm the president of Bluegrass Materials.
I'm Cortez Hero. I'm the Chief Operating Officer of Bluegrass.
Brian McIntyre, Human Resources, Health and Safety for Bluegrass.
And I think that's everybody that's present.
You didn't have the CFO here, though. No, you got everybody else in your hiring except for him. Where is he?
We don't let him out in public.
Oh, okay. Just walked in. Make sure, boy, you had him off.
Before we get started with the presentation, I would like one person to know if you can stand up and introduce yourself, and if you could say anything that you would expect from this meeting or any questions directly or anything.
I'm Mo Delhay. I live on Creeky Lane in the immediate vicinity, and I'm just here to hear what y'all have to say and what questions that the public has. I've been kind of an intermediary between the community and Lafarge for several years now, and recently with Bluegrass, and so that's my only capacity So I just am a little bit of a conduit, so.
Thank you, and we appreciate your comment. I'm going to also, if everybody can do me a favor, I'm going to walk around, and if you guys can fill out these little tags and put your name and your address on it, and then when you have a chance, come over here and grab a pen, and if you can locate pretty close as you can to where you live and just let it hang, and that way we can collect all that information. And we'll be able to actually input the information into a computer and develop a map. And when we further have meetings, we'll have a better idea if there's an issue or a question of somewhere someone lives, that type of information. Any questions on that?
No,
it's a
good idea.
Okay. If you could just put your name on it, and if you have your address on here, we'll get the address off of here.
Pat, do you have any idea where everything is here? Where's Vicky Lane? This is so. Oh, okay.
Thanks for coming.
Happy to do it. I took a tour. I'm all down.
good to see.
Where are you coming from? Are you coming from?
Yeah. Would it be helpful?
While Jeff said
we negotiated, right?
I talked to him yesterday. He said the difference they are so small. They're part of the company.
They're
What's that? Hey, how are you? Nice to meet you. Okay.
Grab a seat, sign in. Oh no, man, long time no see, man. Had anybody throw you out of a meeting or up yet?
filled out one of their tags and stuck it in the map the best they could. All right, I appreciate that.
I guess. My deck?
Yep, you're up.
Well, we got some new people in the room, so I'll reintroduce myself. I'm Court Dondero, Chief Operating Officer of Bluegrass Materials, and I've had the honor of interfacing with several of the people in this room previously. But what I'd like to do is kind of spend a minute talking about, you know, kind of our history, who we are. I think it's always a concern, who owns this quarry? What are they all about? And basically, while Bluegrass Materials is a relatively young company, it's privately held, our origin dates back to, you know, 1929 with Florida Rock Industries. And we used to work at Florida Rock, Ted and I. His grandfather founded Florida Rock. And when we were purchased by Vulcan Materials, we thought it'd be best for our own survival if we kind of started our own business. And basically, we sat down and built a business model as to what we were, what we wanted to be, how we were going to get there. And so part of this history would be who we are, in the sense that we got a very, very rich history, a very clean history. If you go back and check out Florida Rock, Florida Rock was a very profitable company, very well run. I was responsible for aggregates in Georgia, as well as Alabama and Tennessee. And we are just, to be honest, we're very, very happy to be back in business in Georgia. So we have a history within the industry within Georgia too. So whether it be vendors or whether it be people who are part of the Crushed Stone Association, we do have a long-term history with those people. So we're not some fly-by-night company that came in here that just to buy this thing, see what we could do, run it, flip it. We know what we're doing. We've been in the industry for a long time. But I think what's more important is to talk about, you know, the purpose of this meeting. And I can appreciate there's been a lot of emotion, including on my own part, in the sense of this whole situation. But I'd like to say is, I don't want to consume this meeting rehashing the whole permitting thing relative to the new subdivision. And I'll be more than happy, because I don't want to blow you off here, more than happy that if you want, I'll make myself available and we can talk about that. The problem is, we get into that, they'll consume the whole night and we'll never really accomplish what we want to do today. The other thing I found out, and I used the word emotion, anytime you're dealing with somebody's home, you know, they've worked hard to purchase that. That's where you live, that's where you raise your children. And it is, it gets very emotional. That lack of information can be just as bad as anything, really. And I found, in fact, we kind of tripped on this. We purchased a quarry. We heard that there was going to be a subdivision. You know, we're very pro-business. So if someone's going to build a subdivision by the quarry, that sounds good to us. It wasn't until they're asking for a variance for a sewer that this thing, like, you lift up a rock and you find one worm, you lift up another rock. And the problem was, we could never really get our hands around good, solid information. And what we want to do is, I can't correct what happened in the past. But what I can do is make sure we're not going to be part of the problem going forward. We're asking for a variance for the noise level. And we owe it to you to tell you why, what's going on, so you can understand it. And not only that, we brought in independent, third-party people who can explain this to you in much greater detail than I can. The only thing I asked was, keep it in common sense when you walk out, that just say, all right, I know what's going on here. Also, information, we had a lack of information, but the other part was, the information that was out there was not accurate. So you try and get your hands around, I don't really know what's going on, but what I hear I don't like. And again, we want to be as accurate as possible, and just kind of hate to use the word transparent, because I think that word has been overused, but I want us to be a good neighbor. And the only way to be a good neighbor is if we have an effective way of communicating with you as to what's going on, so you know. Let's just talk about some of the miscommunication. I've read articles that were in the paper, people emailed me, scanned copies, and the one that kind of really I kind of bristled up on, I started reading about the toxins and all the nasty stuff that we produce here. And the reality is, we do not have a cement plant here. There's no cement manufactured on site here anywhere. And whoever wrote that, said it, truly does not understand what happens within this quarry. There is no manufacturing or grinding or pulverizing of cement. It does not exist here. And whatever article that person took it from, they were obviously, maybe they Googled cement or cement factory. And that led down this whole gamut of toxic stuff blowing through the air. It does not exist. Number two, our business model is we own and manage rock quarries. We have 14 production facilities in the Southeast. Of those, two of them, we manufacture concrete block, in which we pour solid concrete block that's used in the coal industry up in eastern Kentucky. So we do not deliver ready mix. We do not manufacture asphalt. We do not deliver asphalt. So basically, we have six tenants on site here who are all connected with the construction industry. And all we do is we sell them rock, crushed stone, that's used in their different businesses. So the ready mix is used in making sidewalks, streets, curbs, could be patios, driveways, and asphalt roads. And we basically sell crushed stone to those people. So I wanted to kind of calm down that hole, because I read it. I wouldn't want to live next to something, what I read about, because it was very, very inaccurate. Very disturbing, really. So I wanted to diffuse that kind of bomb out there. This shows our locations. We're in the Southeast. We have multiple locations in Western Kentucky, Eastern Kentucky, South Carolina, and then we're here in Atlanta. We have four operations that we just purchased from Lafarge. And we take a lot of pride, and we also have one. It's close to Jacksonville as you can be and still be in Georgia, St. Mary Sand. The Edgefield Quarry is just north of Augusta. But I think what's more important is, let's just talk about what we have here. We purchased these quarries from Lafarge. Lafarge is a very, very good company, had a great safety record, and which is, and the culture, and when I say culture, I don't talk about Lafarge's corporate, I'm talking about the people here in locations. We were very excited about this opportunity because, one, they're good assets, and they came with good people. You know, we were blessed in the context that we picked up some very, very good people to help us continue to grow Bluegrass Materials, who treat their job very seriously. And safety is paramount in everything we do. So whether it be someone's ability to come in and work without getting hurt, or their ability to work without damaging something, or even a vendor being on site who does something that's not correct, it's not tolerated. As a matter of fact, I asked Brian today, you know, could we get an update on our, for example, our lost time injury incident at just this quarry here?
Yeah, we've gone almost 7 years with no lost time injuries until February. We had a man that fell and dislocated his elbow. Nothing major, but it counted. Prior to that, we've gone almost 7 years without any injuries.
So one lost time injury in 7 years, or over 7 years, and it wasn't on our watch. So we take a lot of pride in that, and we count that at all our locations. Our people are judged by that, how well a job they do. MSHA came into this location, that's mine safety, and we're governed by federal regulations, and they do two inspections every year at every location we have. And they were here for over 3 days, climbing through everything we own, looking for any kind of violation. And a violation could be something really nasty, or it could be you got an extension cord that's frayed somewhere. I mean, so it could be something that's nasty, and it could be something like, you gotta be kidding me, type violation. But we were blessed in a sense. We had 3-day inspection here, not one violation, not one citation. Yes.
I got the question. I didn't write that letter, you know, that email, that concrete cement email. For those of us who don't know the difference, like me, what is the difference between concrete and cement?
I'm going to give you the simplistic one I gave my wife. Think of cement as the glue that holds the aggregate together. It's a powder, and you grind it down, and it's got multiple chemicals, but it goes through a big kiln, and it's a very, very large plant that manufactures cement. And think of cement as a powder. And then when you mix the cement with crushed stone, you end up with concrete. That's a very simplistic definition.
So you do have cement on site. Otherwise you couldn't make concrete, correct?
Our customers here in their ready mix operation, but it's a very small percentage.
Well, and the cement isn't, is kept in a silo. So that's what you see when you see concrete plants with the big silos. They're keeping cement in there, and they move it around pneumatically with hoses so it never is exposed to the air. And then they put it in the concrete truck that you see spinning around. Mm-hmm. And that's what, you add a little water, and that's what glues everything together. And that's what makes concrete look gray. And so the same thing with asphalt, the way they glue that together is the tar that you smell when they're putting asphalt on the ground. So those are the general glues that they use to bind what we make, which is the rock and sand, together.
But they buy the cement, correct?
Yeah.
It's not manufactured on site.
Right. The cement, a cement mill is a $200 million facility, and there's usually one that'll serve an entire state. So there's one in Birmingham where they get a lot of cement from, and then a lot of cement will come from South Carolina over near Hilton Head. But there's no cement manufacturing facility, I think, in the state of Georgia except for one down near Macon. So it's a really big facility, and that tends to get people riled up because cement facilities do burn things. They're burning limestone at almost the same heat as the sun's surface to make it into the calcium carbonate glue that they make it into. So, and those expel nitrous oxide and things that people get worried about. But here, they've got it contained. It's really a harmless substance once you put it in a silo or once you put it on the ground in the form of concrete.
Okay. If you were to list everything that's, let's say, including our tenants, you'd have gasoline, diesel fuel, that's all contained, and everything is within code. Everything here is within code. And we tend to take it above code. In other words, if the code says it's got to be level 2, we'll take it up to level 4. In other words, so we look at it as whatever the government says or the regulation is, that is the minimum standard for us. But it's a good question. Yes?
Your batch plans, if I got my compass right, are on the north side of your property. Mm-hmm. Is there any plans to put batch plants on the south side of the property?
Yes. You got two plants down there.
Yes.
We do have two
plants. Two plants down there. There's two plants on the south side of Redding.
And those are concrete?
Yes. Thomas Concrete and Vulcan on the south side. And then on the north side, you have Argos and Candler Concrete.
Thank you.
Yep.
These are good questions.
So I got another question. You plan to expand on the south side? Because that's where most of the people would be exposed to your activities.
I do not know of any plans.
We don't own any more land, so we can't. I don't think we can expand.
And you have no plans to put more batch plants on the land?
No, we don't have any plans to put more batch plants in there.
Right now, we're just trying to keep the ones we got.
Well, in fact, I'd like to kick those guys off up to the north side and mine the rock that's underneath them, but we've got a lease agreement with them that we've got to live by for a little while.
So what have I said? One is, we've been in the business for a long time. We've got a rich and very prosperous history relative to what we do. Our business model is we run rock quarries. We do have two block plants, but they're up there in Northeast Kentucky. we sell crushed stone to people that would use it in construction. So it could be the base for your driveway, it could be the base for your foundation, and then we sell it to the people who manufacture ready mix or concrete and asphalt. And typically they're our two largest customers. The other thing I talked about was if you want to chat about the zoning thing, I will make myself available and we can pick a date or whatever and we can kick that around. Our main objective is, during that zoning process, something came up that we were not aware of that affects our ability to function properly. And that's why we want to explain it to you why. This is not something to like just call it out of the blue, well, we need to do this. It's like, this is a byproduct of the one event. The other thing I said was, going forward, we don't want this just to be a one-time meeting. As we're going forward, we'll figure out what the frequency, what the right number would be, and whether it be once a quarter or once every 6 months, or as needed, we will work with you to make sure you understand what's going on. So at any time, if the picture's going to change here, we'll share it with you. Is that fair? What I'd like to do now is, did I leave anything out that I was supposed to cover?
Sounds good.
Okay. John, do you want to?
Sure. I'm John Kendall. I'm the applicant and the attorney from Atlanta, which I'm sure Mr. Meadows would agree I'm by far the least important person in this room as far as what we're doing here tonight. I am the applicant, so I definitely want to make a few important points to each of you. In fact, I think it's important that I start off with something that's in writing, it's in the application.
Applicant for what?
The application for the noise.
Oh.
He's our lawyer.
I do that.
Let me back up for a minute. Okay. We've applied for a variance to the noise ordinance due to the ADA rezoning. Before that rezoning, it was agricultural, and the county did not have a noise decibel rating to be next to us. I'll be happy to answer.
He was talking.
Oh, sure. Please. Sure.
Yeah.
No problem. He can't hear very well.
The county did not have a noise decibel.
I live right over there. I just wonder about the noise.
Yes, sir. Yes. The county did not have a noise decibel level requirement for agricultural. Now the property is zoned residential, making it a 60 decibel level requirement. Due to that, we were forced to file this application, asking for 80 decibel levels over a 12-hour period. The 12-hour period is not my ask. That is what the county has said by administrative decision will be the duration that sound is measured. Okay? I want to read something that's very important. I want to stay on topic. This is the actual application. To be clear, we do not request a variance to operate at a noise level greater than that at which the quarry has always operated. That's very important. We're not asking to get louder. And I'll be happy to answer any questions on this. Just stay with me. We're not asking to get louder. We're asking for the ability to always be compliant. Now, we've got noise experts in here. We're going to go through that. We're going to explain where we are, we'll explain what we need, and we'll explain why. But it's very important just for this initial talk, we don't want to get louder. We want to be compliant with the ordinances because the county and their authority have put residences beside us. Okay? So, and let me just sort of give an intro to what the noise experts are going to say. So I know you're going to have questions about it. You're going to see that on certain property lines, you're going to see a 66 point something decibel level over 12 hours. Okay. This variance is very hard because we need to understand that noise is not static. On a perfect day when this was taken with no clouds and no wind, 66 decibel levels is what it measured out over 12 hours. And this is the peak operating hours. We didn't do it at night.
Time of year.
Correct, time of year.
When did you do it?
Just recently.
3 weeks ago.
3 weeks ago. Okay. So it was a perfect day. And so what we're saying was it was 66 that day. We need to make sure we're compliant on a cloudy day and a windy day and a mild-rated traffic day. We don't think we'll ever get to 80. We just want to be compliant because there's new residences, potentially these new homes coming in, who are really going to complain about us. Yes, sir.
The decibel level scale was told to me recently. I don't know this for a fact, but maybe you can help me, that it's not a linear scale, in that an 80, going from 60 to 80 might be perceived to be a certain percentage increase. It's not that simple. Apparently you can go up 4 or 5 dB and you've actually doubled the actual sound, is the way it was described to me. And so that's one of the things I was trying to understand about. What is the decibel scale, and is it something that's equal to what we might know on a linear scale, or is it something that's much different?
That's exactly what we have.
We're going to talk about that here in a little
okay.
bit. So good question, Brent.
And I'm going to pause and with 2 points. One, we're not getting louder. And two, this problem came to us. And I'm going to let the sound guys talk, and then we're going to answer questions, and I'll probably interject as we go. Mm-hmm. This meeting is for you. I'm the applicant. I've got to have it. I've got to know what you're thinking. You know, all we want to do is continue to operate how we've always operated. We're a new neighbor. We want to be a great neighbor. And so, please, once we're finished, let's have a dialogue. Let's talk about this. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Well, I'm late. Well, happy to answer your questions.
Right.
I'll go ahead and introduce myself. My name is Matt Pills. I'm with FiberTech. And for those who are not familiar with FiberTech, we are consultants. We specialize in acoustics and vibration. And tonight, hopefully, the other Matt Engel and I, hopefully, will be able to answer most of your questions. Again, I'd see some new faces here tonight. Just to tell you a little bit about FiberTech, we're a really old company. We started in 1949. We employ 110 employees across 18 offices throughout the United States. Typically hire engineers, geophysicists, some rock people. It's typically our group. What I want to do is tonight is I really want to focus on just a couple topics. I want to give everyone some background, just basic background about sound. And it's a very technical topic, really is. And so we want to talk about some terms that we're going to use throughout the evening. And also want to talk about some characteristics of sound, whether I measure the sound close in to the source or I measure it real far away. And a lot of folks, from what I can see on the map here, are pretty far away. And then we also want to talk a little bit about the ordinance. Some people already brought that up. And then finally, we want to share with you some recent measurements we took at the newly zoned subdivision, and then also some of the areas around the quarry as well. So let's talk a little bit about sound. Sound is basically it's a vibration in the air. Okay, so that can be whether it's a bird or a dog barking or kids playing baseball. Those are all sounds that we pick up from our ears and we transmit that into a signal. We say, oh yeah, I recognize that. That's a robin in the spring, and that's Billy coming home from school slamming the front door. Okay. Talk a little bit about noise. Noise is things that you don't want to hear, okay? It could be your grandson or your son playing the drums. It could be a thunderstorm and your dog's scared of thunderstorms. It could be anything that you just don't want to hear, okay? And those are typically qualified as noises. Let's talk about some of the technical terms. Decibel, it's a unit measure of sound pressure. So basically when we start on a scale, we're going to start at zero, and that's sound that I can hear. I'm going to go all the way up to a whisper, and that's about 20 decibels. We're going to go all the way up to a rock concert or a jet airplane, that's going to be over 100, okay? Brent brought this up a little bit. The calculations are logarithmic, all right? So because I have a scale that's from zero to, you know, way over 100, I have to have something that's got a relationship on a log scale. People are really good picking up sound. I mean, we can pick up changes in sound about 3 to 5 decibel change. So if I was talking at 50 decibels and now I'm talking at 55, you could probably just start to pick that up. But if I go from 50 to 52, maybe you can't pick up that change. Brent talked about this a little bit. 10 dB increase makes that sound twice as loud. It's a logarithmic scale, right? So it's a factor of 10. I go from 50 to 60, that's twice as much energy, okay? So if we take some measurements, and Matt actually took some measurements here recently this past month. I'll talk about a maximum measurement. It's a dBA LMAX. So if I turn on my microphone and I record it for maybe 5 minute period of time, I'm going to have a peak reading. A car would go by, and I'm going to measure that maybe at 70 decibels. And then I'm going to have a peak min. That's when I didn't have any traffic. Okay, go ahead. And a peak min is during that same 5 minute increment. That's my lowest sound reading that I had during the time period. So what we do a lot of times in the county that does this as well is we do LEQ measurements. So I take that first measurement I took at zero, you know, first second, all the way out to 5 minutes, and I average that total sound, and I come up with a measurement called LEQ, the equivalent sound level. So it's basically a summation of all that and then average. So that's what my ear was exposed to during that time period, that 5 minute time period. Go ahead.
So in that averaging, you could have a level much higher than what the actual dB level is set at, but through averaging, you could achieve that.
Yeah.
And so minor changes in the increase in the decibel level could have a very large impact on what you may perceive or actually hear.
Yeah, you can have other things happen too, Brent. You could have an airplane going overhead, okay, and all of a sudden now your sound meter jumps to 70 decibels. Airplane goes by, now that's you know, maybe it's an airplane that went by once a day, but I have to take that sound sample then, and now I'm up at, you know, 70, 80 decibels with an airplane going overhead, and then I'm down to 40 when there's not much happening. So it's just an average, and that's what the county uses. They use an
right
average.
And my point being with averaging is that you could have spikes and peaks. For instance, you could be in operation for 6 hours at a very high level and go completely silent for 6 hours. And that was one of the things to understand what you might be hearing.
And that's in the code as well. That's
correct.
A good point.
Correct.
Go ahead. Talk a little bit about the scale. Basically, human beings, we can hear from 20 cycles to 20,000 cycles. So when we're young, we have a really good range. And as we age, our hearing starts to fade on both ends, okay? Typically in the high frequency areas. Basically, when we do our measurement and our models, we separate the sound into 10 octave bands, and I can look at the energy levels in those different octaves. Okay, some people have hearing loss when they age, typically in the higher octave bands. They just can't pick up those sounds anymore. Here's a nice scale here. This is kind of showing you from top to bottom. Threshold of pain, dBA, 130 decibels, 120 decibels, jet airplane taking off. I know some of the kids go to these concerts. I know my daughter was at a One Direction concert recently, and I know they experienced it, came back for a day or two, and she kept saying "what" to me. And I know I understand why, 110 decibels in a rock concert. Different activity, trucks, 90 decibels. Passenger car, about 70 decibels. Normal speech, if I'm about 3 to 6 feet away, probably about 60 decibels. Typical suburban home, 50 decibels. And I talked a little bit about the whisper, about 20 decibels. Sometimes you really got to focus and listen in, but whispering is very, very low. Just to give you a little bit of a scale. So what does affect sound, okay? How does sound change with distance, okay? It really depends on the distance from the source. So we know sound is comprised of different frequencies, and we also know it has different frequencies have different wavelengths, all right? a low frequency wave has a wavelength that's real long, okay? And a high frequency wave is a real short wavelength, okay? And we talked a little bit today already about sound dissipating 6 decibels every time I double my distance. So we looked at some of your areas over here where your houses are located, and we have a measurement in close to the quarry or near the highway, then I could go ahead and project out, keep doubling my distance, and I can tell you probably what that measurement is. The other thing you have to need to take into account is there's also ambient noises, things that are going on all day long, cars, planes, trains, school buses, and that's just ambient background levels that we all perceive and hear. Low frequency waves have longer wavelength, and we talked a little bit about that, and longer wavelengths can go over barriers, okay? So if I'm generating a lot of low frequency energy, I can bend up over a barrier and come back down again, okay? So it really depends the type of sound that we record and measure. Depends on what kind of attenuation or what kind of blockage that our company will try to provide, whether it be a barrier wall or planting trees. Go ahead.
Let me ask you this then. When you did your measurements, you measured inside the quarry, is that correct? And partly out that 88 Davis Creek, right?
Yeah, we actually measured
the location I'm asking about.
Yeah, and I'll show you that. I'm going to get to that here in a second. But looking at the county ordinance, we have to measure on the property line, or very near the property line. And that's what I'm going to share with you. Mm-hmm.
And because if you, of course, if it is more, there is more noise, so to speak, the frequency is higher if you are closer to the plant. However, that does not necessarily mean that the people on Vicky Lane, for argument's sake, will hear less decibels, less noise than you will hear here. Because Vicky Lane is geographically lower than the quarry. And if I'm not mistaken, noise travels like this. Right?
Yeah, a lot of times on the elevation, if your elevation is lower, you'll actually have a faster decrease in sound levels. So some of the guys working around the plant, they might hear the levels of, say, they're 200-300 feet away, but you're so far away, probably that the ambient levels, you're going to hear more of the ambient background noise than you're going to hear inside the pit in this area here. But we'll show you this on the map. Okay. Sound attenuation, I talked a little bit about doubling the distance. Here's 1 meter, here's 2 meters. So if I'm going to go from 1 meter to 2 meters from a point source, I'm going to drop about 6 decibels. Then I have to double my distance again to drop another 6 decibels. So I'm out here to 4 meters again, okay, 24 feet. That's typically the rule of thumb from a point source, okay? And there's around the quarry today, there's point sources, and there's also line sources of sound. We're going to talk a little bit about line source here in a second. Okay? You talked about some of the things that affect it. Elevation, okay? Distances affect how fast sound attenuates. Elevation. I've had people say that they're up high on an area and they can hear certain sounds and people down low can't hear. Natural barriers, hills, forests, bodies of water. Sometimes I hear people say because they have the lake there, they don't hear as much. So I've heard other people say, well, I hear certain sounds a little bit more. Weather, rainy days, overcast conditions, wind direction, all those affect the sound that we hear. And again, we took our measurements in ideal conditions that were blue sky, perfect weather conditions, low wind, just like the standards talk about. John talked about the code a little bit. I talked about the 60 dBA for projects near residential areas, 65 for commercial areas, and 75 for industrial mining. And from my understanding, listening to John, he talked about this agricultural area, there wasn't really a level associated with that.
Yes. Excuse me. Have you seen the zoning conditions for where the construction for the concrete plant is? Because I know that it had a different requirement as far as noise and some other requirements for pollution and other things that were put on there. Is there anything? Have you got that?
I've got them right.
We talked about that. Yeah. Is that the same as what?
Uh,
I'm not sure we're talking the same thing.
I tried to go online a second ago, though, and find it.
While they are looking for that, I got the question. You said you measured your noise level in optimal conditions. No, no brilliant weather. You must have been in a different state. But my question is this. When you measure without leaves on the trees, the noise level increases dramatically. So wouldn't it be feasible to do your measurement again in December?
Sure. As long as it's good weather conditions, higher than a certain temperature.
Sometimes that's rain which stops.
And typically we see when the leaves come down, it depends. There's a lot of evergreen trees here in Georgia, and so you don't see that change that much. But some areas that just have a lot of the deciduous trees and the leaves come down, it's about 3 decibel difference. So some people really pick that up. Yeah.
Between here and Vicky Lane, most of the trees are whatever, they drop their leaves, whatever you call deciduous. These trees.
Talk a little bit about the area that was just recently rezoned, and what the track looks like compared to the facilities here at the Bluegrass Board, and the proximity is to the tenant properties. One of the things that the sound ordinance doesn't deal with is it doesn't talk about ambient noises. And Matt, you want to talk a little bit about this?
Sure. Ambient noise will be anything that you hear just at a specific location. This is what we're measuring at the property line currently. It'll include, obviously, noise that's coming from the property here due to the operations going on, tenant properties, and at the crusher plant over here. And it also picks up other noise sources that aren't on the property, say, for example, roads along Ronald Reagan, birds, insects, different things that'll change from time of year and based on what time of day it is. The issue is that the code that the county set up for the noise doesn't differentiate between the noise that's created on site here and the noise that's created by, say, Ronald Reagan Parkway. And there's a lot of variation between night and day on these ambient noises. Say insects are going to be louder at night. Road noise is going to be louder during the day. And then every once in a while we'll have conditions, like a couple of years ago we had the cicadas, and I don't know if y'all remember, but there were a lot of real active bugs a couple summers ago. I was working on another sound study in a few counties over. We were getting 70 decibels just routinely throughout the day just because of that insect boom. But that's just another factor that we wanted to address here. I was talking about the noise along Ronald Reagan, and a lot of the property along the west portion of the property bounds up against Ronald Reagan Parkway. You can see up at the north there, we're getting about 64 decibels right there at the edge of the property. Same thing right over here in the middle. And then at the entrance where you guys came in this evening, we were getting 65.1 decibels. It's about the same level all the way across. There's not a whole lot of fluctuation there. We were talking about that 3 decibel variation that you can kind of hear. So pretty much all the way up and down the highway, we're getting the same effective noise level.
I have a question. On your noise variance, is this a noise variance for the entire quarry, or is it just for the section next to the newly zoned residential?
It's for the entire quarry.
But just to kind of show you what was going on there, the plant's over here on the east side of the property, and at the locations where I'm taking the measurements over there, the noise from the plant is hardly even audible. The primary noise source is going to be from the traffic, cars and trucks going along the highway there. We came down here to the south and took another set of measurements, and you can see down there we got 64.7 decibels, and then 61.8 it looks like, which is just about on par with the other measurements that we took over here near the quarry. And over there, you can't hear any quarry noise whatsoever, but it's just about the same measurement, just to kind of show you that what we're seeing over there on that side of the property, at least, is pretty much all coming from the highway.
Well, we live on Vicky Lane, and the quarry is maximum half a mile away, probably much shorter as the crow flies. We don't hear Ronald Reagan, but what we hear are the concrete plants.
Right. Do you have measurements on the right side of the quarry? That's where we would be.
Yeah, we're going to show you that here in a second. We talked a little bit about point sources. That would be if you just had a single piece of equipment making a sound source and it just emanates out, kind of like if you took a rock and dropped it in a pool of water. Area sources, and that's typically, it's pretty easy for us to do the math here, 6 decibels, and we did that before to attenuate the sound source. Area sources is where you have multiple sound instruments or sound sources, whether it be industrial plants or crowds of people or things that are kind of overlapping. And sometimes those are a lot harder to try to figure out how to attenuate the sound in those areas. A line source, Matt talked about Ronald Reagan, okay? It's a moving source, so these are point sources, busy highway, local roads. It's about a 3 decibel decrease from that line source for us to bring our distances down and our sound levels down. So just to kind of show you the different sources that you need to model, it gets to be very complex, is what I'm trying to say. For our study, we use a type 1 meter, and that's a real precise instrument, able to see the whole range of hearing that we talked about earlier, and very good at doing some octave band analysis and other analysis. Type 2 meters are good for field use. They're not as good in the high frequency zone, typically, that we find, but this is the type of instrument that we used here this month.
Can I mention something else? Years ago, we were involved, myself and some other people were involved with Lafarge and the attorney of Lafarge at the time. And Lafarge had a noise study done on Vicky Lane, among others, on our property. You may want to ask them for the readings, because that way you can actually compare if your noise level here went up since, it must be 8 or 10 years ago. Maybe more.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not familiar with that study. Yeah. That's a good question.
Yeah, they did that. They came to us and did it.
This is some measurements that Matt took. These are 12-hour LEQ measurements that are similar measurements that the county would be taking. Operational hours, I believe, from 7 to 7, Matt?
That's correct.
7 to 7. Here's the concrete plant that the folks talked about, the Thomas Concrete Plant. We have about a 69.5 there, and we go ahead and calculate what we can see at the property line, about a 66.5.
What's the top number at 10?
I don't know. I don't know that offhand.
I don't remember immediately either.
But if you're getting that on an LEQ on that 12-hour, you had something probably up around 80.
It's possible. Usually you'll see about a 10 to 15. Mm-hmm. Decibel increase, just depending on what's going on. The concrete plant does operate at a pretty steady level. Mm-hmm. They've got a dust collection device over there that runs constantly.
Well, have y'all got it recorded? Because I've got it right from the property line, and I mean, you know, I'd love everybody in here to hear it. Because I mean, you.
The
peaks are really what I'm interested in, because
that's where it's
5
at.
5 o'clock this morning, I was sitting on my couch, and I live about 1,500 feet. I guess that way. We're the adjoining property. It's been in the family for 60, 70 years. And 5 o'clock this morning, I'm reading a book, and I hear somebody banging on a bin or something. Bang, bang. You know, and I've got my alarm system on. I've got all the windows are down. Doors are closed. And I'm thinking, I hope that guy's wearing hearing protection, because I know that's over 85 if I hear it here.
Mm-hmm. They were crushing rock last week at 6:33 in the morning. I woke up. They don't abide by those rules of 7 to 7.
And see, and that's the problem with 80. Because if these guys sell and somebody else comes back, then, and this gentleman is saying, we just want to do what we're doing. And that may be the case. What about the next bunch to buy?
When y'all did the lease to the sheriff and he had that illegal gun range down in there, And that wasn't you guys, but it was Lafarge who leased unlawfully to the sheriff's department. It destroyed, you know, the sound around here. It would ricochet off the valley in one of the most ungodly noises. But what I do know is that at the time Lafarge put up some significant rubble berms out there. They called them their backstops. But anyhow, I'm interested in noise abatement. And there isn't any berm at all on that side between us and here, and that's something I was interested in seeing, because there's a significant area out there to where you could put, I mean, y'all got more rubble and quarries, you got the trucks, you got the equipment, putting up a huge berm out there, you know, 20 feet is, you know, 25, 30 feet is really no big deal, and that's something I'm interested in, and just curious from your standpoint, what would that do to help abate that issue?
Yeah, that's a good question. There is a bit of an elevation drop there, mm-hmm. which actually is kind of helpful in some ways. And it really depends. We can go ahead and model with the numbers that we have here. We can go ahead and model different type of berms,
mm-hmm.
whether it be typically evergreen trees. They typically plant on those, and the different they model different heights and see how that would attenuate the sound quicker for you. It really depends on the type of sound that's emanating from the plant. There's some of the sounds, some of the high frequency sounds, a berm just not going to do much for
yep.
it. But on some of the low
like with that banging sound there, I don't know that that's going to do a whole lot with it. But with that humming noise, that could do a lot.
The lower frequencies, we typically
yes.
find that. And then we also find that there's a bit of a kind of a shadow effect on the other side of the barrier.
Mm-hmm.
And we see that for a distance as well. But that would be something that probably a little bit more advanced analysis that we probably need to do if we,
mm-hmm.
Down the line to get there. But just wanted to share with you these levels. The next slide shows you a little bit. This was done on a Sunday. Matt was able to do this for a 12-hour LEQ on non-operational. So we know ambient levels are down typically on weekends, and there's less traffic. People aren't buzzing around going to work and shuttling people from here and there. And we had a 47.5 on a 12-hour LEQ there, non-operational. So you can see how the ambient levels really seem to have a big effect of the basic sound footprint that we have here at the site. Again, these were taken on ideal conditions, great weather, low wind. We didn't have rain. We didn't have a lot of low overcast. So that's a perfect day for us as far as taking a measurement. A lot of these levels would be higher on great conditions. We talked a little bit about wind. If you had wind blowing the other direction, you're probably not going to hear as much sound that day. Your sound levels would be down a little bit more.
And predominantly in our location here, it comes out of the west and it goes to the east. Occasionally we get that wedge out of the northeast there. But predominantly it's all blowing and shifting and coming all our direction.
Did Thomas know that you guys were doing the measurements that day? Were they aware that you were out there measuring the sound?
Yeah, so I spoke to the guy that was running the plant out there, and he knew I was on site.
So you spoke to him before you started doing your measurements, right?
Right.
Okay. Next question would be, just to clarify this, you are taking the measurements only for the quarry. You are asking for a variance only for the quarry, or are you asking for a variance for the quarry, including all your tenants?
We're asking for a variance for the entire 159.
That means including your tenants, and they will have to abide by whatever
correct.
You guys are saying.
That's
correct?
That's right. That
okay.
is true.
Because I know one of the concrete plants, like you were just saying, in the middle of the night, they start banging God Almighty. I don't know what they're doing, but it sounds like they have one of these big, you know, in the movies, these big round metal things, and they're hitting that with a huge hammer. And as I said, you know, you sleep with an open window, you are wide awake.
But don't fear, that averages to 65.
No, actually what I do is
I
pick up the phone and call the police and tell the police to shut them up.
Exactly, that's my point.
Yeah, I do that. I don't have
still,
a problem with that.
You're still at 65.
Yeah.
And so, if you can't make 65, it's kind of like...
That's higher than 65.
If I get pulled over speeding at 65 miles an hour and at 55, they say, you're doing such a good job, we're going to let you go 70. We're going to reward.
Well, I mean, let's face it. Effectively, the people who don't listen or the companies who don't obey by the rules and regulations laid down by Bluegrass, it's not Bluegrass's fault. It will be Bluegrass's fault if they then don't take action. You know what I'm saying? We had the same issue with Lafarge, and Lafarge stopped it.
So they're definitely one of the reasons to have this meeting.
So it may be that we need to have y'all, you know, you call someone that's here at the time to try to figure out what's going on. Because
but you're not here in the middle of the night.
Yeah, I'm not.
That's what it's about.
But someone should be. Or someone,
yeah,
you know,
can we have your business card?
No,
I'd be delighted to call you.
I'd be delighted if you could give me my phone number.
He just gave me his cell phone number. I got it. Yeah,
no, I can call around and find out what it is.
I mean, it's just as easy
we'll
to call you as 911.
Yeah, well, I'd rather you call me than the police.
How is wild.
We're going to have a time for questions.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and we would like to discuss some of the ideas that y'all have about some things that we could do. And I think one of them is to find out that the things that are causing you issue now, find out what it is and find out what we can do about it. Because right now, it's the first I've known of there being an issue. So mm-hmm. It's kind of, you know, you let us know, give us an opportunity. You know, let us see what we can do. We'll go ahead and summarize, and then we'll get down to some discussions. So get your ideas together, and we'll see what we can come up with.
You know, this is a bright crowd. I don't know that I really need to read that. I think it's time to have our discussion now. You know, I've said that we're not going to create more noise. The gentleman makes a good point. I agree with that. That's a good point. Noise abatement issues.
Yes.
Good point.
Yes,
let's talk about it. Let's talk about it.
As far as putting up those the berms or something, I think that's easy for you guys. It really, I mean, that's an afternoon of work for y'all. What might cost me a couple of hundred grand is going to probably be just, you know, the fuel and the diesel and the labor for putting those berms up. I don't know, but that seems like a reasonable start that would be cost-effective for you guys and us.
I'd like to ask a question. If 70 decibels is twice as loud as 60,
correct?
80 is twice as loud as 70, so it doubled twice from 60 to 80, right? It's like going 2, 4, 4, 8. It's not like going 2, 4, 4, 6, correct?
And it's
using simple arithmetic.
Yeah, no, you're right. And the thing to think about is the way the county has it set up, the county has it on a 12-hour average.
Well, hold on. I understand. I guess what my question is, if you guys are at 65, how far off is 70 from 65? Why are you going not just from 60 to 70, but from 70 to 80? Seems like you're kind of trying to take more than you really need. Whoever I'm, I guess I need to address.
I think we can both address that. That's definitely one of the top two questions in this file. The issue with clouds and non-optimal if it's wet, we in summary don't ever think we'll be at 80. Because there's going to be next door neighbors, we want to always be. Don't want to put ourselves in position.
CYA, in other words.
In that set of
non-CYA
conditions that you have,
not
that
CYA.
You were showing,
we
Jonathan?
We don't want to shut down. We don't want 400 people to go out of work. It's
well,
not CYA.
Well,
it's truly continue to operate.
Well, let me ask another question. There's lots of industries in the county. People have air permits. They have stormwater permits. They have wastewater permits, and everybody else is, you know, expected to manage their liabilities. But here, it's almost like because of the encroachment of residences, that that rather than really managing the problem, we're just asking for a mulligan.
That's it, isn't it? Think about this. In a prior commission, there was a setback requirement of 800 feet from that concrete plant from any residential structure. It used the word existing, okay? So a prior planning or a prior board of commissioners anticipated that there was a need for a buffer in there. In fact, so much so that they labeled it and made it a special condition, which was 800 feet. Now, arguably, you're going down to, you know, it'd be 100 feet from a residential home, maybe 125 feet. It's hard for me to even believe that you could sell a home that would have that concrete plant back there doing its thing back
there. And they
won't.
To the courts.
Yeah, it's a weird scenario of things that created this event where we are now, because you guys maybe had an anticipation that you were going to be 800 feet, you know, from anybody, and now all of a sudden, they're right next to you.
I appreciate the point. Mm-hmm. And exactly what the court said at the beginning, to rehash 88 is a waste of tonight. Mm-hmm. I agree, believe me. I personally agree with you, but we didn't do it.
Well, the other issue, of course, is because of the 88 creek taking down, clear cutting, whatever you call it, grading, whatever that is called, right? Because their stipulations are only if it's feasible do they have to leave the hardwoods in place. So let's say it's not feasible, they cut everything down, because otherwise they won't get the money. That means all the surrounding areas going that way will have lost a major noise barrier. That will mean your 70 decibels will travel unhindered much further than they were than they could travel before. So having said that, even though you may get your variance to 70, that will encroach on the quality of life of a lot of people, as far as Windermere, probably down to the swimming pool.
It wouldn't be unimpeded.
It wouldn't be what?
I don't disagree with your point.
Yeah.
Again, a problem we didn't create.
Yeah. Oh, I know that. I'm fully aware of that.
But I don't know that it's unimpeded. I'll just talk through it. I think we at least have our buffer plus their buffer. Y'all believe, you guys know much more about what they just did than I do. I don't know what their buffer is. Is it 100, 75, 50,
25? 25 and another
25.
35
plus another 25.
Very
nice. Plus our 75.
Yeah. Which means for 12 hours, that's 7 to 7. And there will be, I don't know how many young kids, but there are a good few young kids on Vicky Lane, I think, pretty much close to you. Or older people, although their hearing, according to you, is sort of disintegrating a bit, will be affected. You know what happens when you keep waking up a baby, right? You get a very grumpy baby. So you are left holding a big baby, because you have to do something. You have to fix something which you didn't create, but which is the effect of some unfortunate and short-sighted decisions of the county. So between you and us, we have to figure out how you can fix it at your cost.
And again, I'm the least important person in this room. However, for the record, since there's a video camera, we are legal nonconforming. We don't have to fix it. We want to help you.
All right, yeah.
Okay. I don't want to admit anything, but this is for us to talk about what needs to be done.
Yeah. I didn't mean you have to fix it, right. You know, but.
No, I just like to double what the gentleman over here said, is that basically we're looking for an increase in sound, which is four times as great as what the current ordinance is, and we're seeing the sounds are all, you know, the sound readings are all 60, 65 decibels. You know, my concern is going to 80 when 70 seems like we'll do the trick, because, you know, you may get another tenant in there, and all of a sudden, they have a bigger window that they can operate in, so it gets louder. And I think that's a huge jump, and you know, looking at the sound levels doesn't appear to be necessary if the intent is to operate at the present sound level. And I realize you can get different sounds on different days, sure. But you know, by the same token, I would think that, you know, if you got a higher sound reading on a cloudy day, you would be able to come back and say, well, you know, let's get it on a good day and use that as a comparison rather than picking the worst day of the year. The other thing too is that for the most part, it seems like the objectionable sounds are going to be the low frequency sounds, and from what the presentation said, those wavelengths tend to travel over and around, so it makes it a little bit more of a concern in that the majority of the sound is the noise that's going to be offensive is at the lower frequency.
That's a good point. Appreciate it.
Yes, sir. If a worker is exposed for 12 hours to a sound level, what does OSHA require air protection at?
85.
Okay.
What my question was going to be is, because you guys have talked about, you know, doing your testing on a pretty day, environmental factors negating wind, what will clouds do? Is the clouds going to push a 70 to an 80? I mean, is it going to double the noise just to have clouds? It just seems like we're just asking for an awful lot. That's all.
It's really a combination of a lot of variables, and that's the unknown here. We don't know. We know that cloud cover does increase it, but you combine cloud cover with rain and then wind, that increases it more and more and more. So, again, it's a moving target for us, and it's very difficult for us to pinpoint that. And that's why, you know, a lot of the ANSI standards that we, you know, review and study, they always talk about, you know, these conditions, because that's basically a baseline for a good window to take your measurements. You know, I could take bad measurements and I could take, you know, one end or the other. I want to kind of hit it right in the middle so we have something to work with.
Right. But you wouldn't think atmospheric would double your noise level?
No, I probably wouldn't double it. But again, if I have a strong wind, if I get 20 mile an hour winds coming out of the, you know, Brent talked about coming out of the west and coming down,
no. But he's just asking about clouds.
Yeah, I was negating wind.
Okay, yeah. No, but you can get a couple decibel increase. I mean, mm-hmm. You definitely can. And
Are there any, I guess, existing, what am I trying to say, are there any houses that are already zoned residential that would be affected by an existing ordinance? Say, for example, up here in Ronald Reagan, are you touching a property that you should be at 60 already?
I don't know the answer to that. I truly don't know the answer to that question.
You see what I'm saying? You could possibly be already, you know, breaking an ordinance for that.
It would just be smart. You guys know more than I do, but as far as, it would depend on, I know we've been here a long time. It would depend on when that became zoned residential.
Right.
It almost definitely is legal non-conforming if there is a residential property adjacent to us. Just due to the age of.
I was just wondering about current compliance versus what you guys would want to accomplish.
Let me add one thing here, just kind of put it in total perspective. If we didn't exist, Ronald Reagan's in violation. I mean, if we didn't exist, the noise level already exceeds the 60.
But there's not an ordinance for a road.
But we're just talking about the noise, the noise level. So there's an ordinance that basically is unworkable. I mean, it means if that's the number, kiss all business goodbye. Because just the infrastructure here with no industry creates more than what this rezoning did.
Look,
and again, we're not asking, in other words, we're not asking to increase more.
For 60 years, and we've never complained one time about the dust, about the dishes falling out of the
cabinets,
the chandelier rocking.
Not like electric guitar.
At 110 decibels.
Electric guitar.
We've lived through the worst of it.
Yeah.
And we've never been over here complaining one iota. But, you know, if we ever wanted to zone this property back here, this 40 acres he's sitting on, we'd be staring down at 80 decibels. And we don't know what the future holds. And see, we won't have any recourse then. We're just protecting, just like you're protecting your interests. We're just protecting apples.
Here's your interest right now. That's a good point. There was no decibel level.
For agriculture.
Absolutely
right.
We're not at a level right now.
You're absolutely right.
And you can protect, you can at least
get it. It has been non-residential and I changed it back.
After the recession, we saw it back.
Oh, I see.
Are
you guys inside the horseshoe of 88 Dave's Creek? Where's your property?
On Creek Drive.
Oh, okay. What do you want to ask, Doug?
I wonder, when you blast, what's the decimal? When you
it's a little bit different scale. It's two different type of microphones.
Oh.
Typically, it's a linear weighted microphone, and there's about a 60 to 70 decibel difference from what we talked about today to air concussion from a blast event. So typically they run in the teens, 110, 111, 112, somewhere in there. Sometimes we don't even give measurements less than 90, 97, but two different scales. You're talking about an L-weighted scale, and what we were talking about today, the ordinance is talking about 8-weighted sounds, things that we hear. The other one's more of a concussion, what we can feel. So
let me ask you a question. What happens, what is the direct effect if you are not going to get your variance? What will happen? You're shutting down or what?
No, we become non-conforming.
Say that again?
We become a non-conforming. Legal non-conforming.
And if I understand this correctly, you don't have to do anything. In case you get your variance, you don't have to do anything to noise protect surrounding or further away properties. Is that correct? Do I understand that correctly?
That's correct.
Okay. So the meeting is here basically to inform us that you're asking for a variance to go up however many decibels. And should you get that, it's just TT for the people who are living around here. And if we ask you nicely, you may consider doing something about it. Is that correct? Putting it in a nutshell.
You don't have to ask us nicely. We're here to discuss what
needs
to be done. We want to be a good neighbor.
Right.
We're not here because we're just shameful.
I understand that. But what I'm asking you is this. So we come up with some possible, not fixtures, because it won't be, you can't fix this. But you can make it less invasive, perhaps. I don't know if you can actually make noise less invasive short of putting a glass dome over this whole operation. But that's basically what we are trying to establish, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
It's an information, and then how do we make it best so we can all work together?
Okay.
Are there any plans for ongoing monitoring stations? I know it, like the shock waves, there are still days where there are large shock waves felt. And I know they had put the station out a while ago. I don't know if they're still active or not.
Yeah, there's some seismic monitors around the perimeter of the quarry and in certain neighborhoods. And those monitors get moved from time to time according to where they're blasting, what kind of comments that they've had, what we're trying to research. One of the things that Joy Sand is going to be working with is a kind of a committee to address some of the blasting concerns, and it's been an ongoing process because they do mine in different pits in different areas, and it's something that they're very attentive to as well. They make adjustments to each blast. They get the readings, they make some adjustments to go ahead and blast again, get the readings, go back and make some more adjustments. So they're very proactive with that process. It's a good question.
Where should things be reported if there is an issue? Because I think like I don't know how long ago, it's been about within a month though, there was one blast that was actually a pretty big shock.
2 weeks ago.
I usually just jot down on notepad.
If you email me or call me, then I have their email and I call them.
Okay.
Or you call them directly.
So will they fix the tiles?
One of the things that you can do, also there's a sign-up on the sign-up sheet, there's a place to indicate whether you would like to be on the Neighborhood Advisory Committee. I encourage you to check yes, you know.
What is the definition of that committee?
We're going to resurrect the old committee that LaFarge had held. It was, they met not on a really regular basis.
No, we didn't meet, yep.
And Courtney mentioned it a little earlier.
No, you're fine.
So, it's a chance for you to give us feedback on how we're doing.
Okay.
And, you know, make recommendations on, you know, if you are having issues with noise, dust, vibration, whatever. It's a chance for you to let us, you know, let us know so that we can see how we can address it. You know, it's like I said earlier, unless we know, you know, we're sitting over here, you know, dumb and happy, thinking that everyone's happy, and then we, you know, we get into a meeting and find out that's not the case. But, you know, give us a chance. Let us see what we can do to help fix some of these issues. And
yep.
That committee is a, it's a set up so that there's a, you know, format, you know, there's a routine meeting for you to be able to come into to share that. So if any of you would like to participate in that, please check yes on that form, because, you know, we would like people that will give us honest feedback so that we don't get surprised that we're not being as good as we thought we were or whatever.
I thought that the quarry was going to start, you're in the base of your pit now, so I thought we weren't going to hear anything, any more noise from you guys.
Now the stripping shot's what could give a new issue. And Tiny, how much more stripping will we be doing in the area that created an issue?
That's the direction of mine is migrating across that area, so until it's open to quality stone.
So it'll we'll be
give
a
them a time
while longer.
A time frame. Next
so you're
3 to 5 years.
What is the likely life of the quarry?
It's
100
about
years, 50
years,
years 20?
About 70 years or longer.
70 years or longer.
About 70 million tons, and by now we're mining about a million tons a year. I mean, as the economy comes back, we'll be doing more, but it's probably somewhere in the 2050s, 2060s.
Okay, a long time.
Yeah.
Kathleen, that doesn't mean that you're going to continue to fill shots like that, though. It just means that that's the direction we're moving.
I'll be sleeping at my house.
Let me throw out here one thing that I'm going to walk away from this meeting, and is we accept responsibility for the full 500 acres. So we've got six tenants, and obviously we're going to do the best we can as Bluegrass, the part that we run each day, but I'll personally, and we're going to sit down, we're going to talk to each one of our tenants or lay down the law. I mean, that's all I can do. I'm going to sit down and say, look, they may not recognize, they may not be the one who got the phone call, but if it comes from our property, we're going to react. So whether it be, and be very frank, if somebody's got a sledgehammer beating the heck out of the back of a dump truck or whatever, we're not going to know it. But if you tell us and give us some sense where it came from, I'll talk to that business owner very quickly.
I have one final question. The variance is for 5 days, 12 hours a day, or is it for 6 days, 12 hours a day?
Okay. It's not for 12 hours a day. The 12 hours a day is just how it's measured.
Oh.
To determine compliance.
So it's not from 7 o'clock in the morning until 7 o'clock at night that you can make that noise, no? That noise can be made?
It is, the 12 hours is just how it's measured. So they could be any 12 hours during the day.
Right, during any day.
Right, but that doesn't answer my question. Yeah. The
from what time to what time is the variance, is the higher decibel supposed to be audible or can be audible or must not be audible after? And is it 5 days a week or 6 days a week or seven?
Yeah. To give an example to her question, I think I understand what she's asking. There used to be an ordinance in a neighborhood where you couldn't fire up your weed eater, you know, before 7:30. You know, like kind of like an HOA code or maybe a county ordinance or whatever. And quiet times 10 p.m. Mm-hmm. I guess
what
you're
asking
is there
That's
any kind of
yeah.
limitations?
Yeah.
And it being industrial is probably just a different follow up.
Now, we got into that conversation earlier today amongst ourselves. So what makes this a bigger picture than we all really realize is if they're paving a road out here, that's got to be done at night. Because you imagine what the county, if the county's going to pave a road out here, they want that done at noon to shut down traffic.
It's based on demand.
It's based on demand, but also the fact is that there are regulations where the county controls when that road can be shut down and when they can do the work to try and minimize traffic congestion and inconvenience. So there's things outside the picture that we have no control over. They might say, we got to fix this, and the county's going to do it on a weekend, or the county's going to do it at night. And irregardless, if we didn't exist, they're still going to do it at night.
But the direct answer to your question, you're asking, are there hour restrictions on when we can operate and not operate? I'm not aware of any hour restrictions.
We had that when Lafarge was here, when we talked, like I said, when we talked years and years ago to Lafarge, the then attorney for Lafarge, I don't remember what his name is, he said that Lafarge had decided no noise, no beep, beep, beep of reversing trucks after 10 p.m. and none of them before 7 a.m.
I'm learning a lot here about the history, and what we found out about that was Lafarge met with MSHA, or Mine Safety, and basically they got a variance where they were allowed to put flashing lights rather than the beeping at nighttime. And that had to be, they had to go to the federal government to get that changed, which turned off that beeping that you're hearing on the backup safety alarm. So there's things that can be done. But again, we're learning a lot about the history of things that happened in the past.
Mm-hmm. Well,
I understand that was back when they were doing the 400, which was probably when this thing was maxed out, this quarry, running, that would be wide open running when they were building the 400.
Well, all I'm doing is asking.
No, I appreciate
it. Will you be able to do something like that and say to your tenants, okay, no banging after 10 o'clock at night, Monday through Friday, and no beepers on your trucks? And all of them who were here with Lafarge times, they have that. They can turn them off, provided they didn't buy new trucks.
How long ago was it when they did the 400?
8 or 10 years.
Okay.
I mean, there should be
You'd hope
minutes
they'd have new
and
trucks.
Everything should have been handed to you from the seller, so that you were kept informed of what had been going on here before with the neighbors.
Well, unfortunately, it's not a problem right now because business is so bad. They're not running at night.
It's coming back, isn't it?
But if it comes back, I mean, look, this is the first time I'm hearing any of this, and you're looking at the two decision makers in the company. Not a very big company. So if we start running at night again, I'm happy to sit down and talk to anybody about ways to mitigate noise, because I certainly wouldn't want to wake up at 10 o'clock at night or midnight listening to backup alarms or somebody banging on the side of a cement silo. And that's not being a good neighbor. So that's why Joyce Ann is starting the advisory committee back up, so we can know what's going on. Cause, you know, this is our biggest quarry, and we want to keep operating here. We want people to like us, not despise us. So that's why I'm here tonight, and appreciate y'all giving us your thoughts.
Is it reasonable to assume that regardless, back to the noise again, is it reasonable to assume regardless if you get your bearings or not, or regardless if, you know, your operations are exactly the same, that because that tree cover's down, that the current noise will carry a further distance than it currently is because of the tree cover?
Well, it will, because you told me to let my trees grow in my backyard, and you should see them. They're pretty high, and it's not made any difference. And when the leaves are off the trees, it is worse.
Yeah, you'll see there is a difference. It just, you have to look at elevations, really make a really good determination there as far as the source of the noise and then the receiver point. So we really have to look and analyze the elevations and see if those elevations, if they do take out those trees and the elevations are lower, probably don't have as much impact as if they actually are in line of sight of the receiver point.
Will this new neighborhood block some of that noise from the existing community that's already here?
I was wondering that as well. The houses themselves may act as a buffer, sure, which, sure, you know.
Well, that would be nice.
Like 700 homes, please.
We'll take this down
18 stories high.
Yeah, we want a high rise.
Here's what I've got. Some of these, you know, in fact, I'd like to follow back up. Is it Georgie?
Yeah.
I think Georgie made a very good point. It's one of the harder things to answer in this entire process. Is if you're at 66 and a half, you know, 70 might be good enough. You know, and everybody, we've talked at nauseam about the conditions and how we just never want to be non-compliant. I don't know that 70 is enough because we're at 66 and a half on a good day. You know, can we run up the flagpole at 75? And I don't have power to say that. I'm saying, is that something we can start talking about? You know, I don't know what the Board of Appeals and the Commission are going to do. They may, you know, I just don't know. But I mean, if I've asked the community, what do they think about that? I can at least tell them this is what they think about that. Because, you know, the 80 seems to be a sticking point, and you know, if we're not gonna ever reach 80, and it would give everybody comfort to be at 75, maybe that's where we go. I don't know. I'm just talking.
Are you envisioning your noise level going up for whatever reason?
No, I'm not.
Okay.
I am envisioning it being at 66 and a half on a perfect day, and I'm envisioning a group just as organized as yourselves, in this new neighborhood, who is very organized and coming after us because we're at 72, you know, and all of a sudden that's a real problem for this company, yeah. You know, or just, and so that's what, okay, that was the first thing. Let's consider that. What would that work? Number two, burn. All right, let's everybody realize, we've got to go to the EPD to do anything like that. You know better than me if they're going to say yes to that.
Right. There's a possibility that, I mean, I think there's a strong possibility that they would grant that, but we do have to amend our surface mining permit before we could build a berm in that buffer area, because it's part of our surface mining permit. It's right now shown as undisturbed, so before we could disturb it, we would have to go, even if we planted trees, we'd have to go to EPD and get approval. You know, which I think they would give it with a strong case like we have.
Well, what would be the point? What would the point be to plant trees and to build that when there is a good possibility that the houses which are going to be built are going to block it, at least for the people further away? So if you get your variance in before these houses are built, there's nothing they can do, no matter how organized they are.
We want to be a good neighbor. We're not kidding about that.
I understand, but what I'm saying now is you're not dealing with them yet. It's not built. It may never be built. You never know.
What I'm saying is, no matter what, on the third, right, we're going to go in there. If you guys organize and crush us, then there's nothing. And then they're going to come after us. There's no burn. There's no condition.
That's what I'm saying. I'm just saying, trying to get the yes.
Yep.
To borrow a phrase.
Well, I don't know that any of us have experience with a noise variance. We've dealt with zoning. Is there a county public meeting, like just like it is for the rezonings or land, or do you just have a private meeting with the county?
I don't.
And they tell you on, is it September 3rd or?
No. This is a public hearing on 3rd.
It's a public hearing.
This is a normal variance.
And is it before the Board of Commissioners or the Planning Commission?
Right now it's in front of the Board of Appeals. That's where they put me first.
Okay, so you're going in front of a Board of Appeals, and is that in that same meeting room that normal?
To my knowledge, yes, it's in the same.
Because we've only dealt with, you know, land, and it's the Planning Commission, then after the Planning Commission, it goes to the Board of Commissioners for a final vote. And I don't think any of us have experience with how a noise variance.
It works the same as any setback variance. It's the same exact process.
What you're asking us now is to consider letting you go from the present one to 75.
I'm anticipating the Board of Appeals is going to ask me, or you ask the community,
right,
about 75.
Right.
And now, I think it's important that we talk about
for us, and I'm sure it goes for almost everybody in this room, I cannot imagine what a 75 sounds like. Do you know what I'm saying?
Can you put
What is the noise? What will I hear when you reach 75?
What was it
with anything?
You did that strip blast 2 weeks ago. What was the level?
It would be a different measurement.
That wouldn't cover it. That's a momentary thing, which lasts what, 3 seconds, if that, and is gone. In order for my personal opinion to say, okay, I don't have a problem with 75, I need to know what it sounds like. I need to hear it.
Right. And
so then you make a 75 noise?
The county had.
Anything. I mean.
Get a vacuum cleaner?
Start up your median truck.
Reading this meeting. We've been metering this meeting.
It's 71.
We're at 71 right now.
Since you're 65, who's trying to quiet down? Go ahead and talk.
Well, I talk loud anyway.
you're 76 right now.
I don't hear properly, you talk loud.
So the average noise level for our meeting is what?
71.
But it'd be worse with clouds and wind.
Well, we've got a ceiling.
We do have a ceiling.
So the question for
the
court,
because
yes,
would be, if this variance doesn't go through, these neighbors come at you, could this drag you out of business in this court?
It could have never let that happen.
Well,
I love you guys.
We would never let that happen. I mean.
Actually, I don't think anybody should let that happen. None of the people here in this room should let that happen.
Our concern is knowingly working in violation. It's just not the right thing to do.
Yeah.
And that's why I started off saying, we want to be upfront with you. So we've kind of aired everything here saying, if we didn't exist, the community's in violation already just by its own noise, so it's a level that doesn't make any sense. And I will share this: I talked to people who did vote, and they had no idea this was a consequence of their action.
Oh,
they didn't know. It's almost like you got a vote on it, and we'll read it later.
In the county.
Uh huh.
We tried.
So what I'm saying is, here it is. It's an issue. We're not going to stand back and ignore it and try and run around it. We'd rather just kind of take it head on and talk to the people who are affected by this.
But the thing is when these people move into this new subdivision, they're signing a contract stating they know you're here and there is going to be noise. So they can't do anything to you.
Well, they'll say there will be noise, but if we are exceeding the limit, which even if we don't turn it on, we're exceeding the the problem is it's like a no-win scenario. So we got somebody down there who says, yeah, I signed it. I know the quarry's there, but I'm just going to be a pain.
The condition doesn't make a lot of sense. And you guys know it more than I do. It's the last condition.
It's in the contract for the buyer.
So it's in the contract? I haven't seen it.
Well, that's part of the deal, is that if somebody buys a home, it's got to be in their contract that they know it's there.
I don't have this.
There are some other things which are in that contract.
Well, that's what some of the other neighborhoods
did. They agreed to it. I've yet to see anything in writing to support that.
My point is, I did read the conditions at one point. Forgive me for not having them in front of me. But I didn't read it where they had to be in the contract. It was something like they'll be on some survey.
We actually asked for it, but they said that they took things out that were legally required anyway. So in a real estate contract, do they have to disclose that?
Well, the developers have all of their own contracts. They don't have to unless they are required to do it by the county. You guys requested that.
Well, wait a second.
We requested it and they didn't put it in.
They will have to put it in because the county had that issue.
They didn't put it in.
I saw
the county was
going to
make them. They did.
They had an issue with the rendering plan and what's it called, that subdivision up past 17. They had some major issues there, and so they said anything which is on a big scale, and I would imagine the quarry is on a big scale, has to be. The buyer has to be informed.
Well, the other developers, I think, put it in theirs.
There is
community in that.
There is some condition. I remember, forgive me, I remember reading it and saying, that's not as strong as I know you guys wanted. Mm-hmm. I think it referenced a survey. It didn't reference a contract. It didn't reference a deed. It referenced a survey.
Yeah,
which is completely different.
I usually bring these things.
Right, I just don't.
Didn't you have it?
Let me ask you this. So then from what you said, wouldn't it be advantageous to go with an 80 straight away or 85?
Not in this one, but in other ones.
If you tell us you will never reach 70.
That was our plan.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Wouldn't that be more intelligent
to do?
We would love to have 80. We would love to have 80 to never be not compliant.
Because I know that people sign something.
But you also said, correct me if I'm wrong, that you don't think you'll be reaching 70. So if you get 80, you have a play up.
I don't know. I mean, it's 66 and a half on a perfect day, 7. I don't know that we would reach 75. The thing is, it's one of the, conditions.
Yeah.
80 is better, 75 is better than a potential argument over 60. I mean,
yeah.
Why don't you go for 120, get it approved, and then make a public service announcement? They will never sell a house in there.
Yeah. Yeah. Not a terrible point you just made.
Do any of you gentlemen have any questions that are in the back of the room? Or
I was wondering, what's it mean for you to be non-conforming, financially speaking?
Financially speaking? You can legally operate, but if anything were to, for some reason, shut down, break, then you have to rebuild it. So operationally, it's a problem. It's something you always want to be in compliance. You don't want to be non-conforming compliant.
So will the county fine you if you're in non-compliance, if someone said that you were above those thresholds?
Is
there a fine for being non-compliant? What he's asking.
Yes. There's a whole gamut of what might happen from the county. Fine being one of them.
Worst case scenario, that LLC comes in here and the people are saying you're non-compliant. For one thing, it's not the easiest thing to prove. And secondly, what are the repercussions for you? What can they do to you?
An injunction shows down.
I think you need to ask for eight.
I'm with you, man. Let's go with eight.
Because, you see, for us, who are further away, once these houses are built, and they really act as a noise buffer, we don't care.
Well, the noise buffer is theoretical.
Well, he said.
Yeah, but you also have hard surfaces on those houses. You have stone, you have siding,
no,
and that's
going
to act as a conduit.
No, hang on. I don't think you have siding. I think that wasn't in there.
Well, whatever
hard
they are, it's a hard surface, and
they
it's going to—it's not going to absorb a lot of trees.
Right.
So
reflect
it
back.
So, to recap, are we back at 80?
No.
I don't think so. All
right. I heard 120.
All right. Wait, it will work. So we're going to. We've discussed a burn, we've discussed
trees.
We've discussed
tenant noise.
We've discussed if we were ever in the future to work past a certain time, I don't know what, we would definitely come back to this committee and talk about what needs may need to happen. Right. I know Meadows left.
Yeah.
I don't know what other ideas he may have had.
Oh, he may have had something.
No. I'm saying what ideas he may have had.
Oh. I'm sure you guys can talk.
Yeah.
I just figured a phone call. I did find that condition.
What does it say?
It says, final site plan shall disclose to potential purchasers of homes located within the development that this development is adjacent to an active quarry.
Yeah, site plan.
And it's number 26.
Yeah, so the last one's a site plan.
It's a final site plan.
But it doesn't say the purchasing contract, right?
I don't know the last
one. Well, we can always put signs up, you know. Like, we were advised by our attorney to put signs up that there is a active breeding kennel which will be noisy at times and which will emit smells, which is completely incorrect, of course. Don't tape that.
too late.
And to put signs on our property line, if you buy here, you have to be aware of that. That was what the attorney told us. And that's what's going to happen.
But you don't want them to start the development and not finish it. And then it sits there and gets infested with the
with
mess
what?
That's going on with everybody. What about the other subdivision in North Forsyth that was never finished?
Well,
they've
too
got
bad.
Such a problem.
Oh no!
But that'll devalue our homes. Prices.
Well, but they still have to know, and it's in the county things that they actually have to be disclosed that. You know, so.
So if we present these conditions that John has talked about to the Board of Appeals as conditions to go into that, would y'all support
them? I'll draft some up and send them out to.
Can you not email us?
Yeah,
or,
yeah, sure,
or you know, just shoot everybody an email saying this is what we want to do, and we would like to go for 75 or 73 or whatever. Don't go for 80.
79. We're 79. let us talk. I've got to talk to the decision makers, but I don't know that it's unreasonable that we could send out some proposed stuff.
And the others of you that do have concerns, please write them down on the sheet so we can get back with you, because I know we don't have time to answer everything tonight, but you know, if you write your, give us your name, your contact information, we'll get back with you and we'll figure out what we can do.
So what time is that meeting?
It's 6:30.
Okay.
September 3rd?
Yeah.
Okay. The next
Tuesday.
Next Tuesday.
Okay. It was the Greenleaf subdivision up north.
Yes.
That, yeah.
It was in the newspaper this weekend, as a matter of fact.
Well, it sounds like that one out on the other side of the quarry.
want to see if that's a public meeting that we all, because we just haven't done the, okay, so it's September 3rd. Zoning Board of Appeals, 6:30 p.m. work session. And then Zoning Board of Appeals meeting. At 7.
7.
I don't think we can talk then anyway.
No, we can talk to the commissioners.
Yeah, I don't think that the public can speak at that. I don't think so.
This is a public meeting.
My next door.
Now, please take a plate in here if you would like to take some.
I'm the only one not adjoining your.
Did you cross the road?
I'm across the creek.
Across the creek?
Mm-hmm.
Is there a road?
And they put the public sewer on there.
Can you come up here? Because I asked.
Well, I came like all dressed. I came here.
Straight from Rock.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, no doubt.
Because see the.
You're down here, so the rest of the.
Meet you, very nice.
Where's the road?
So, Matt, the public sewer system.
So the quarry is behind your house?
Yeah, thank you for coming by, thanks for spending 2 hours.
And there are sewers that have pressure.
But I'm just saying.
So everything. I'm close to.
Thank you for coming.
Where are you? So where are the buildings?
Is it down here?
Yeah.
Okay, so I think the name, West, because it's.
The name.
So it's all this.
That they're not using.
So there's like a conduit that has to go right here, open space, right there.
And it goes all the trees, you know, you've been looking at your.
No, it goes all the way over here because it borders right on our property, and this is us. It goes all the way over here, but it's streamless.
Where is the sewer?
If you can look, I don't know if you're familiar with that, but it's right there. They've got a couple of mile houses. You look right down in the corner.
Yeah,
but you see, they can sell these houses. There's one household.
This one here, it's full. They can't build them.
They had 136 lots.
Not that one.
But that's not that much farther than, you know, what you're talking about. No, because what he's talking about elevation, I can't see from here.
What they have is, they don't have this. We have this, that's the concrete plant. No, yeah, the concrete, no, not the concrete. What was I supposed to say? Yeah, that's the concrete plant. I wasn't supposed to say cement, right here.
It's right here, yeah, you got closer.
So you guys are where?
Right here.
Ah, okay, all right. And you hear and feel them that much over there?
Well, like I said, we've been there for a long time, and as he's playing, he's just talking about the future, the way the elevation is.
This coat line, this is straight down.
So basically, you can look through the woods straight across and see the lights.
Yeah, I could lay in my bed and look.
All right,
hey, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Thanks for coming.
My pleasure. If they offer you, bye. If they offer you enough money, they can expand on here.
Absolutely.
You know, just sell.
What do you think it would take to get this zone for mining? You think this is
take a lot more money than
oh
that.
My god, then it'd be worth. And
I just remember how they got that through, and you're right, you know, whether they can actually sell anything another story.
Well, they've not sold much.
I think they have one zone sold.
They should have called it Rock Quarry View, because as soon as you come over the hill, it's all you see is this.
But the reason why these people here don't hear as much as this is from here. The noise doesn't go this way, the noise goes that way.
Well, that's what
and
we're
down.
Saying. I think what we're hearing mostly is more, I don't think it's this, I think it's up here. That's the.
Now, I can hear Ronald Reagan at night, particularly in the wintertime if the windows are up.
I don't hear that.
It's like,
at all.
You know, just barely hear it. But if it's in the daytime, you don't hear it. You hear, king, bang, 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 you know, beep, beep, beep. That's what you hear.
Used to, you could go up on the mountain, and the road was open up there, and you could go up in the Ranger Tower, and you'd see. And I'd seen Rock Quarry, and it looked like a nuclear bomb.
So it's dust?
Yeah.
Oh, there's a lot of dust that comes through, particularly in the.
Nobody kids you. And it.
Yeah, it's a lot.
The dust is mainly in the winter, though.
Wind blowing.
Well, not as close as we are.
No, you can see
not
it.
As close
the
as
dust,
we are.
It's mainly in the winter.
Oh, it's in the grass. You walk
yeah,
out
you sit
the
on
grass.
The front. If it's particularly during the drought, it was, you know, you cut the grass
yeah,
and it's just gray dust.
Really?
Right.
Is that like a 7?
Hadn't been like that this summer. It's just rain so much.
Right.
Definitely. You know, if you just
it's another way you feel.
But the clouds make it louder, though.
We appreciate all of you coming out, really.
And I have two buildings with a cracked piles.
You could used to you call the state. They've monitored them. They've watched them go.
So in that particular shot.
When the thing yeah, they laid up, yeah, it just boom everywhere. They call the state, but the state doesn't call the rock for it. And then when they shut up, they're playing the ball. You know, that's a fact.
Yeah.
And y'all know it too. That was a long time ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. They didn't shake the dishes in the cabinet. Like the man. Then
the red collar, you could go up there. I mean, you could just climb up there and wait on the guy up there. We know him all our lives.
One hour, man.
Yeah, and we could just sit up there and talk to him. Look out. You could see Stone Mountain. Back then.
Oh, in Cartersville.
Yes.
Really?
Oh,
yeah.
And,
unless you have a push
roll. But when they call the state down there, they
look.
Then it's blind, jarry for a mile and a half. And then when the state comes, that up a little sign.
Because,
yeah, like you said that, but. 30 years ago.
When we built, they wasn't a problem.
No, they weren't.
Well, all
they had been 1 year ago.
It was about the size of
years and years ago. I don't know when they
yes.
shut it down.
It wasn't.
They wasn't up but
30 yards wide back there around
yeah.
the circle. And that was quite correctable. That's a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
And they started it back then.
Mm-hmm.
The stone crushes you have, you know this.
What about ratings?
Yeah, they actually aren't allowed in a lot of other countries.
That's an old world that went up to where actually they had a target range.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's actually great.
There was
yeah.
at least
it's real nice.
And then I guess they turned it into an obstacle course now. So
how
much do you guys own?
We don't own, we own a little bit down here, but we lease everything else.
But I mean, who owns this?
Well,
I mean,
we control it.
Yeah, I think it comes down to here. And it
oh,
goes
yeah.
up to the stream.
Yeah, we own this. We own this.
Yeah, yeah, right. Yeah, right. So, okay.
And there's some at Georgia DOT.
Darnell, they're blind down in
yeah,
the stream.
Yeah, he does.
That's right. Okay.